Okay, so if you want to understand something new, right? Something new, there should be some kind of old thing. So based on differences, various differences, we identify the new thing. So same goes for anything, anything in real world. Does not need to be a technical thing. So let's first discuss what is traditional, or what we call as monolithic applications. What is monolithic applications? So in your university days, we used to write some small programs. So let's say it could be a payroll management system. It could be an accounting system. So what are the characteristics? Basically, there is a UI. There is a database logic. There is a business logic, so on. So if you even in your workplace, most of our applications belong to that category. For example, you may use some best practices like the domain model pattern, and you layer your various layers, such as this is my UI layer, this is my service layer, and then this is my business logic, then data access logic, then database. The same goes in EJB, Java EE. You may have your presentation logic, then you have your enterprise Java Beans, then persistent, same way. But there is one common thing. What is that? End of the day, you package everything as a single package. It could be a VAR, that is the most popular format, or it could be a EAR, enterprise format. So whatever the case, we develop whole application as a one. So this is a very simple definition. So in monolithic application, how do you identify monolithic application? Basically, everything we bundle as a single unit, that which include the UIs, how you handle HTTP requests, domain logic, database operations, any kind of a communication with browsers, everything packaged as a single unit. For example, in this diagram, you can see, this is one example. There is a storefront and storefront API. This is the way people and other systems interact with this particular sample. And there are three internal layers, like catalog service, order service, and customer service. And end of the day, we package everything as a WAR file and deploy into a Tomcat WSO application server or any kind of a application hosting platform. So this is the introduction about monolithic applications. Now, is there any drawbacks or is there any advantage? Yes, there are a lot of advantage. That is why we are keep doing this thing. I think at least more than 15 or 20 years, we are keep developing web application as a monolithic manner. So it's great, right? It's great for some kind of a application, not for every application. So these are the drawbacks we can identify. The first one is, assume you develop a monolithic application with 20 modules. So what if you made if you found a small bug in a one component? For example, let's say you found a bug in a small JavaScript page, or you want to correct an image kind of icon. So what's the cost? So you have to rebuild. You have to rebuild whole application, right? You can't just change the part of the application. So rebuilding the whole application means you have to redo the testing cycle, and you have to go through your development cycle again, most of the cases. So that is the one problem of this monolithic approach. Second one is scalability. So now, like the same example, so you have a monolithic application which consists with 20 modules. So now, let's say you experience some kind of a bottleneck in your application, and through some kind of investigation, you found only one module caused this bottleneck. All 19 modules, all other modules are very healthy, but in order to scale, we can't just scale one module. So whether you like or not, we have to scale whole applications. That means if you want to cluster, you have to cluster, make it cluster with complete applications. And nowadays, that is not an optimal solution. For example, if you are deploying into EC2, so you, that will cost unnecessary amount to you. So that is another question. So in summary, you can't scale part of the application. The third one is, for example, nowadays, if it is a 20-module application, sometimes the best suitable technology for one component is not the most suitable technology stack for another component. But since we are packaging as one application, you don't have freedom in such a way that one component can use one technology. For example, let's say one component can use one language, another component can use another language. We don't have that freedom. So if you decide to use Spring, your all 20 modules you have to write from Spring. If it is EJB, you have to write everything from EJB, like that. So that is within the Java stack. But we can't think about write one component using Java, another component using Python. We even can't imagine such a situation. Another disadvantage is highly coupling among teams. So in traditional manner, even most of the today's organization, we have dedicated teams based on their technical expertise level, not based on a business domain. Like you have UX team or UI team, they expect in UX. Another team for database team, DB admin team. Another one for Java developers. So in order to build an application, monolithic application, you need a lot of collaboration and a lot of management and cooperation among these teams. Right? Even if you want to change one thing, you need a lot of people and a lot of coordination among these teams in global. I mean, in nowadays, the development teams can be spread across the world. So in such a situation, it's very hard to coordinate every team to build a single application. And it is, as I mentioned, it is hard to evolve or replace one part of the application. These are some of the drawbacks of monolithic application. Then, what is MSA? Basically, MSA try to address some of these drawbacks. So this is a very simplest or oversimplified version of MSA architecture. So this is based on Martin Fowler. So Martin Fowler is one of the evangelists work on this microservice architecture area. So according to him, this is not a framework, this is not a tool, this is an architectural style. So basically, you can use whatever the tools, you can use whatever the languages to implement this architectural pattern. So this is an architectural style to develop single application as a suite of small services. In simple terms, we separate a monolithic application into smaller component and distribute. So that is the very core of this pattern. So as you can see in here, you can see, so this is the monolithic application, and here we have distributed this monolithic application into several components. So now let's look at how to do that, and what are the advantages and disadvantages, etc. So this is the same thing. This is originally I copied from Martin Fowler. So earlier, when you scale, so you can see that you're scaling everything. And this is the same thing from, according to his famous Faust. So this is one categorization from Gartner. So Gartner come up with the basic grouping or categorization. Basically, what they call is the two architectural viewpoint. The viewpoint means the same thing you can see in a two different angle. The first angle they call is a inner architecture. The basically inner architecture means how do you develop a single microservice, right? That is the inner architecture. Then outer architecture. Outer architecture means how you develop this ecosystem. So in my last diagram, as you can see, the earlier you had only one application. Now you have several applications. But in order to cater, in order to provide some meaningful business functionality, we need cooperation and we need coordination among all these components. Earlier it was one. Now we have, here we have five. So how to coordinate? We need some kind of a environment or ecosystem. So the Gartner called this as a outer architecture. So, and this is their reference architecture. So this is how they place this whole microservice space. So as you can see, this is the inner architecture. That's basically a talk about how to develop a service, right? And these are the outer architectures. So we will discuss as we move on. So this is, first let's discuss the inner architecture. Actually, this is going to be a detailed description about some of the point mentioned by the Frank during his yesterday keynote. So he discussed about loosely coupled. There are a bunch of points, so I'm going to repeat most of these points with some details. Basically, this is not something entirely new. This is evolvement of SOA plus some DevOps. The first one is, what is micro? So when you say micro, what does it actually mean? The micro is a concept about the scope. So micro does not mean you have to limit your application into, let's say, 50 kilobytes. Or you have to restrict your application into the 5,000 code. It is not about that kind of matrix. It's about the scope. So in micro means your microservice must have a single purpose. That means in my previous example, you can't cater your catalog service and your user management. You can't have a module or service to cater your ordering or your users. This has to be two, right? So that is the most important principle behind the microservice. The micro term refers to scope, not about the size. And also, this is not a service implemented with small number of code, also not a kind of a virtual service. So in ESB, we used to create virtual service in order to front or in order to simplify the complex system, but this is not a kind of virtual service. And also, this is not an exposed service by some other party. The second one, that's also very important. The microservices should be independently deployable and independently disposable. So that means our SOA terms, our SOA principles, we are bringing into more and more into real world. So imagine your laptop, your desktop machines. So what happens if your keyboard gets damaged? Are you going to throw your whole machine out? No. Basically, we can just replace our keyboard. If there is a fault in your hard disk, we can just discard the hard disk and bring a new one. So we need they have bring the same concept into the microservices. That means in your solution, let's say you have five microservices. If there is a problem with a microservice, you can just discard that particular microservice and bring a new instance. That is something very new. Because earlier days, what we used to do is, so if there is a server down, we go through the logs and we try to forfile it and try to debug, and as soon as possible, we try to bring back that existing server. But in microservices, if something went wrong with a service, we don't worry about the logs and etc. I think later we need to analyze what's went happen and so on. But we are not waiting or we are not blocking until we get the existing service alive. Instead, what we are doing is we just discard it and start a new service. So this is what we call as the independently deployable and independently disposable services. Third one. So this is also not something new. So there is a law, or there is a principle defined by someone called Conway in 1967. That means when you develop a software system, it will represent or it will reflect the how information flow happen within your organization. Right? For example, so in your organization, you may have a separate UI team, separate business analysis team, you have separate programming team, you have separate database teams. So if you have such an information flow within your organization, you will end up building some kind of monolithic application. Even within the application, you can find these layers. That is simply the Conway law. So according to Conway law, so this is my example. So we have separate UX team and business logic team and DB teams. So this is our architecture, separate UI layer, separate business logic, and separate database. But so this is not a technical thing. This is more or less the practice or cultural change. In order to build a microservice-based solution, we have to make this cultural change. So if you look at the microservice-based software team, it consists with UX experts, programming expert, DB expert, DevOps. So this kind of so we need this kind of a culture. This is a cultural change. Then, decentralized data management. The earlier days, what we used to do is, there is a single database. So each and every module, regardless if it is a customer record, it is a order record, it is a kind of a user record, everything goes to a single database. But in microservices, there is no such a centralized concept. Or in correct way, I can put it as a there is no restriction such as you should have only one database. Instead of each and every service can have their own data sources. Instead, actually, it encourages to have your own or independent data sources. Again, this microservice support technology heterogeneity. So when I start, I mentioned in a traditional monolithic application, you can't write part of the application using .NET and other part of the applications in Java. But here, you have that freedom because each and every module or each and every service communicate through some well-known protocol, such as HTTP or JMS, MQTT, this kind of a standard protocol. That means as far as you have a well-defined APIs, we don't need to worry about the internals. So one for example, in this example, post. This is example about Twitter analytic application. So you can save Twitter post in a document store. And relationships among the people within this network, you can save it in a graph database. And pictures, you can save pictures in a file store. So basically, now you have a freedom to select or choose the best technology for each and every component. So that is also another advantage of microservice architecture. So this is pretty much about the inner architecture. Now, what's the relationship about MSA and SOA? Some people, the obvious thing is, like Frank mentioned, some people think the SOA is dead and this is microservice and there is another thing come. But microservice is some people tell microservice is a better way to do the SOA. So as you can see, so all of these principles, these are other than this, this independently disposable and deployable feature, most of them are came from SOA as well. So SOA also asks you to define your services around business capabilities and use the well-defined contract and implementation. So these principles are still valid. Then what's the new thing? Basically, we call it as a microservice is a SOA principle plus DevOps practices. That's again something technical and also something cultural change. So basically, earlier days, so we had development teams separately, and we have separate administrators or DevOps teams. Basically, this DevOps team is care about the deployment and maintenance of your application. So you just develop it, and we use one of the popular words, we deliver. So we deliver, we complete our solution, and we deliver to this DevOps team. After that, we are not going to involve. But this is the huge difference. In microservices, there is no programmers, dedicated programmers. Also, there is no dedicated DevOps people. Basically, if you are a microservice developer, you need both the programming skills plus DevOps skills. So this is a combined practice. So that is something new. So there's a lot of overlapping, and there's a lot of there is number of relationship among microservices and SOA. This is basically, according to me, microservices is a SOA plus DevOps in a very simple terms. So now let's look at microservice outer architecture. So these are some of the outer architecture component. So basically, you still need service gateways. So now you have microservices. How you provide service, the security, and how you provide a throttling. So for that, you need some kind of a API management gateways. And some cases, you need to route something. You need to route based on some properties. You need to route messages into the right microservice. To do that, you need service routing and load balancing. Then there's a service discovery. Now, in microservices, as I mentioned, microservices are independently deployable, and same manner, you can discard at any time. So when the new services are up and running, how the external world, or how client get to know about the existence of new services, that is happened through the service discovery. Again, service discovery is not something new, but we are reinventing, or we use the same technology again. So what happened is, when a new microservice boot up, we published into something called service registries. To service registries, the client can get to know about the existence of new endpoint, and they can call the service. So that is how it happened. And shared configuration, dependency management, message channels, these are some of the outer architecture. So let me go through some of the challenges. The first one is end-to-end monitoring. So this is a compulsory thing. So far, I think 5 years back, it is good if you have some decent analytic platform. But with microservices, you can't have a microservice-based solution without analytics. Because your service is composed with several services. Then at any given time, you need insight about what's going on each and every component, or what's going on with each and every service. So you need analytics. So basically, there are several areas, and these are three key areas. The first one is service level and deployment level dashboard. That is something traditional, the traditional application performance monitoring. So how your service deal with the HTTP calls, how to deal with the how well deal with the databases, and etc. That is traditional thing. And also the deployment level, how many machines are up, so what are the network traffic, this kind of information. The second one is really important, tracing, replay, and log analysis. That means, so when a transaction is entered to here, there should be a mechanism so that you can track, okay, now this service is, this message is entered to here, now enter to here, now enter to here. At this point, there is an error occurred. So you need this tracing capabilities, end-to-end tracing capabilities, and replay and log analysis. The third one is service instrumentation. So now, unlike earlier days, now people move into APaaS. So you develop your application and push it into the some kind of a cloud offerings. Then the cloud offer should provide some instrumentation. For example, database call took 30 seconds. Other calls took only 10 seconds. So then you can identify there is a problem with the database calls. So in order to identify this thing, you need this instrumentation. The second most important challenge is security. So earlier days, So from once you authenticate from the UI, you can easily go through other layers in Spring or EJB because we are running within the same JVM, right? Now, each and every layer is separated from network. So that means we can't compromise the security. So we need to propagate this security with proper trusted and proper level of integrity. So for that, there are two requirements, the how to do the authentication and authorization in microservice architecture. Second one is how to propagate this security context from one service to another service. For example, there are two patterns. The first one is, so we can use a gateway, some kind of a security gateway. So the client come to the security, with the first message, client send the security token. At the security token, we contact whatever identity provider and validate the security token, and we can use some kind of a other token. The first token, we call it as the reference. So that is that could be a JWT token or so on. The kind of O token and so on. So then you can use, after authentication, you can get some kind of a JW token. That is a value token. And you can propagate this JW token to consecutive calls. For example, through the oath token, we can get to know this is the user, and he has rights, and this is his roles, and so on. Then through a JW token, we can propagate this information into other services. That's the one way. The second one is you can have a dedicated security service, right? This security, the first service, most of the cases UI-based application, the first service identify this security requirement and get the token and pass this token into other services. So this is how you do the security. Then service discovery. So as I mentioned again, so you need to have some kind of a registry. To a registry, you can register whatever the new services, and also client can query and identify the available services. So the last challenge is deployment scalability. For in order to realize this deployment scalability, you need the lightweight containers and also lightweight container manager systems like Kubernetes. I am not going to discuss, I think you had a lot of talks around this area. So now the important point. So why we are develop a solution or microservices framework? Why we are doing? Not because everyone else doing. So we see a clear value as a company. So in 2015, last January, exactly 1 year ago, the Gartner claimed there is no commercially supported holistic microservices platform. But now today, after 1 year, we can tell we have two things. The first, we have competitive microservices framework to support inner architecture. So that is WSO2 MS4J. Second, we have a complete platform. We have complete platform to support outer architecture. So when I say complete platform, this includes analytics, security, discover, gateways, message queue, etc. So here, this is the mapping. This is the Gartner reference diagram, and this is the shape when we map Gartner reference into a WSO2 product. So we have every piece and every bit and piece to meet the Gartner's reference architecture. So this is the same thing in a detailed manner. So now about WSO MS4J framework. So I'm not going to discuss about this thing. So there is a separate session by Aziz under the app dev track. So if you are interested, I encourage you to attend that one. He will discuss about the internals of the microservices 4J framework. So again, so microservices in all some drawbacks. The first one is their complexity is moved. So there are some complexity with the monolithic, but now we move that complexity into different layer. Earlier it was with the program development, now it's moving to the deployment. And also it is hard to do the centralized governance, increased network communication, and network security. Earlier you are within a JVM, now you have to go through network cost. That means you have to think about network security and also monitoring. So these are the some of the drawbacks. I think I'm already took 1 or 2 minutes. So if you have any questions, I will be here, so you can ask. Thanks for your time.